This conference will now be recorded.
So the name thyroid is derived from the Greek word called thyroidis, which means shield. You must have already known this from your anatomy class in the first year. So it is a butterfly shaped swelling present in the infant of the neck. Coming to its anatomical perspective, it is a ductless gland. And compared to parotid and the salivary glands, which have ducts, this gland doesn't have a duct. Pancreas has a duct. Every prominent gland always has a duct, which secretes and opens into a certain structure through its ducts. But whereas in thyroid, there isn't any duct. So the average weight is about 20 to 25 grams, and it is always larger in females. And thyroid diseases are also more common in females compared to males. So it has a narrow region of isthmus in the center, which connects the both right and left lobes of thyroid. So when it comes to the surface anatomy, always remember thyroid extends from the C5 cervical vertebrae to T1 thoracic vertebrae. So that is a very important question which will come across in many areas in future. For example, in your ENT, it might come across. In your final year, again, it will come across. In your entrances for the PG, you will come across this. So always remember this C5 to T1. Extension is always C5 to T1 vertebrae. The examiner might also ask at which tracheal rings does it extend. This is the thoracic level. While he may also ask about the tracheal ring extension. So that extends from second to fourth. C5 to T1 in the vertebra, second, third, and fourth in the tracheal rings. So coming to a brief thyroid. So coming to the embryological part. So this is derived from the foramen of cecum, which is a downward extension from the median analog. Thyroglossal ducts develop at the sixth week of age. So as the developmental progression continues, the distal remnant gets detached and forms the pyramidal lobe. So in the functional aspect, it begins to function at the third month of age. So follicle, at this stage of development, you can see colloid in the follicle. If you take a histological specimen from a fetus thyroid, you can see colloid in the follicles. So again, ultimobranchial body gives rise to parafollicular C cells. So this ultimobranchial body arises from the fourth and fifth brachial pouches. There is a bit of a confusion regarding the parathyroid gland. You should always note that superior parathyroid gland arises from the fourth branchial pouch, while as the inferior parathyroid gland arises from the third pouch. This is very important because the inferior parathyroid arises from the superior brachial pouch compared to the superior parathyroid. So inferior is from third pouch and superior is from fourth pouch. This is the picture depicting the embryological aspect. So there is a certain entity called as tuberculous junker, So this is identified in about 60% of the patients. So this is a embryological fusion of the ultimobranchial body and the median leg. So there is no functional difference in the presence of tubercular junker, but in surgical scenario where you are dissecting and trying to find the superior thyroid artery, etc., what happens is when you are doing a total thyroidectomy, you should remove everything. So you should not leave behind a bit of thyroid tissue. So what happens is this tubercular junker is an outward extension of the superior thyroid, superior pole of the thyroid, which extends into the tracheoesophageal groove. So without identifying it, if you dissect and complete the surgery, there is always a chance of a remnant tissue present. So you should always be careful and look for it while doing surgery. And another surgical important is the recurrent laryngeal nerve runs medial to it, if it is present. Again, the thyroid has clinically what we know is a capsule, but there is a true and false capsules. The true capsule is the contents of parenchyma and signs extends between the two lobules of the thyroid gland. So while dissecting, you will always come across different levels of sheets of layers in the body. So false capsule gives you a negative depiction that you are dissecting a true capsule. So always true capsule should not be breached while dissecting a thyroid. Because if you breach the true capsule, what happens is you are entering into the parenchyma tissue of the thyroid. So there will be bleeding and distorted architecture. You cannot, it will be very difficult to progress in the surgery. So always be very, very careful while dissecting thyroid. You should never beat the true capsule. So this false capsule is the pre-tracheal fascia. So in it contains the multiple unnamed veins, and venous flexures might be seen in the false capsule. And the suspensory ligament of Berry, this is very important. While dissecting the posterior part of the thyroid, it is attached to the what do you call trachea with a very tense tissue of adhesions called as the Berry's ligament. So in infiltrative carcinomas, example in papillary or follicular carcinomas, what happens is there is a very tough ligament of Berry. So dissection will be very hard and should be very careful, because if you miss the plane while dissecting the posterior aspect of the thyroid, you can either rupture the trachea or you might injure the esophagus. So which are very dangerous consequences. This is the most common question while differentiating a thyroid swelling from some other swelling in the neck, like a neck lymph node, etc. So why does thyroid move the decollation? The main things are during the first stage of decollation, thyroid bone moves up. So this pulls the pretracheal fascia up. So as the pretracheal fascia is attached to the ligament of Berry, that pulls the thyroid upward. Here you can see, this is the pyramidal lobe. You don't find in every surgical patient the pyramidal lobe. So in some patients, due to the remnant tissue, some people might come across pyramidal lobes. So coming to the relations, both the lobes are conical in shape. So it has apex. This is the apex and the base and three surfaces that are lateral, medial, and posterior lateral, and two borders, anterior and posterior. So this is important because you should know while dissecting on which areas the thyroid is resting on. For example, posteriorly there is esophagus and trachea. In the posterior lateral aspect, there are tracheoesophageal groove. RLN nerve is present in the posterior lateral surface, etc. So you should know the exact anatomy for a better dissection. So coming to the apex, it is present exactly when an oblique line is drawn at the level of thyroid cartilage. You can always say it is present at the level of thyroid cartilage, extension from the level of thyroid cartilage, and base is at the 4th to 5th tracheal rings. So the lateral surface is always convex. So here thyroid is always hugging the trachea and esophagus, so it doesn't stay like a open winged butterfly. What it does is actually it hugs the trachea and esophagus, so the lateral surface is always convex. So it is covered by sternohyoid, sternocleidomastoid, and superior belly of pomohyoid and sternothyroid. These are the muscles that cover the lateral surface of the thyroid. And coming to the medial surface, so this is the medial surface. Medial surface, it is trachea and esophagus, and two muscles that are tricothyroid and inferior constrictors. Coming to the anterior border, this is the anterior border. So obviously it tells itself that the superior thyroid artery is present and superior thyroid vein are present in the anterior border. And in the posterior border, there are inferior thyroid artery and the anastomosis between the superior thyroid and inferior thyroid artery. So this anastomosis happens on the posterior surface of the thyroid gland, where the superior thyroid and inferior thyroid gets anastomosized. And there are parathyroid glands and thoracic duct. These are the posterior borders. Coming to the isthmus, isthmus is in its own an entity. So it has an anterior surface, posterior surface, and superior border and inferior border. Coming to anterior surface, it's always the skin and fascia, anterior jugular veins, commonly encountered while dissecting. The posterior surface of the 2nd and 3rd tracheal rings, and superior border will have the anastomosis between the right and left superior thyroid arteries. So here is the right superior thyroid and here is the left superior thyroid. They come down the both the glands and get anastomosed in the center. They form a plexus there. So coming to the blood supply, it is very easy to remember superior thyroid, inferior thyroid, and in some cases thyroid hema arteries. So superior thyroid branch is a branch of external thyroid, external carotid artery. So it is present here at the both the upper poles. Sorry. So both the upper poles, superior thyroid artery is present. As I was discussed earlier, the superior thyroid artery gets anastomosed at the isthmus. Both the superior thyroid arteries gets anastomosed at the isthmus, while as the superior thyroid and inferior thyroid gets anastomosed at the posterior border of the posterior surface of the thyroid gland. So superior thyroid artery supplies about 1/3 of the lobe and upper half of the isthmus, while the inferior thyroid supplies the 1/4 and half of the isthmus. So coming to the inferior thyroid artery, while dissecting, finding the inferior thyroid artery is a little bit difficult when compared to the middle thyroid vein and superior thyroid artery. careful dissection should be done to find the inferior thyroid artery as it lies in close proximity to recurrent laryngeal nerve. So the chances of injuring RLN while dissecting an inferior thyroid artery are very high. So utmost care should be taken at that particular step. So this is inferior thyroid is a branch of thyrocervical trunk, or in some cases subclavian artery. In some cases it can directly rise from aorta, but there are very minimum number of cases reported. Whereas the thyroidema artery, it can rise from the aorta very commonly. You don't find thyroidema in every patient. The main branches are always superior and inferior thyroid artery. As it is specific to any other artery in any other part of the body, so the artery divides into four or five glandular branches. These are the plexus, which forms into capillaries and pierces into the gland and supply it. So this is the thyroidema artery. About 12% patients, it is found in about 12% of the patients. So it can originate from the right common carotid or subclavian or internal thoracic arteries, and also can originate from the aorta. So coming to venous drainage, it is self-explanatory. There are superior thyroid vein, inferior thyroid vein, and middle thyroid vein. So this is only the extra that is present when compared to the artery, that is middle thyroid vein. So the first branch which we ligate both in arteries and veins while dissecting a thyroid is the middle thyroid vein, which will come across first. So it drains into the inferior jugular vein. So I'm not going in detail about the drainage, as the drainage is self-explanatory. Coming to the lymphatic drainage, the thyroid glands usually drain into the level 3, level 4 lymph nodes, and in some cases into the level 5 group of lymph nodes. So in extensive metastasis, so from 3 to 6, 6 or 7, every level of lymph nodes can be metastasized. So early detection is more indicated in papillary thyroid carcinomas. There are seven groups of lymph nodes in the neck, which are very important and we will come across throughout your medical profession, be it in surgical or be it in medical. The lymph node examination is very important, particularly in the neck. So depending on that, you can rule out specific entities. So mouth and oropharynx can lead to certain set of lymph nodes enlargements, whereas carcinoma of the thyroid gets into certain set of lymph nodes. So it is very essential to remember the levels, the seven group of lymph nodes. So the first one is the submental. The second divided into 1A and 1B, but at your level that is not important. Just remember the names of the seven groups of lymph nodes. That is, first one is the submental. And second one is the lateral compartment, which again has 2A and 2B. So this lateral compartment has superior jugular group of lymph nodes, jugular digastric group of lymph nodes, and superior spinal accessory group of lymph nodes. So important one is the superior jugular and jugular digastric in the second group. Coming to third group, it is the middle jugular. So this is the jugular vein. You can see that in the picture. Based on the jugular vein, it is again divided into the lateral compartment, middle jugular, and inferior jugular. Fourth one is the inferior jugular. Again, fifth is the transverse cervical. it is present lateral to the second, third, and fourth group of lymph nodes. Again, it is divided into 4A and 4B. So that this is a bit confusing, but those names are very important in your future. And sixth is the central. This is very easy to remember. Sixth is the central group of lymph nodes in the region of the thyroid gland. And seven is the mediastinal lymph nodes. That is behind the sternum. In the mediastinal group, you can't palpate mediastinal lymph nodes, but it is of surgical importance. So seven is the mediastinal lymph nodes. So coming to the nerve supply, parasympathetic fibers are derived from the vagus, and the sympathetic fibers are from the inferior ganglion of the sympathetic trunk. So coming to the important one, that is the recurrent laryngeal nerve. It is about 1.5 to 4 mm in diameter, depending on the patient. So it is always characterized by the whitish to yellowish color present in the tracheoesophageal groove. That is very important in identifying the RLNs. So there is another one called as non-recurrent laryngeal nerve, but it is only found 0.2 to 4%, about in the region of 1% of the patients. I myself have never seen it during any of my surgeries, but it is of clinical history. You should always remember that. So whenever it is present, you should always suspect other anomalies for the patient, either vascular anomalies or anomalies or subclavian anomalies, etc., are present in those patients. And transposition of the great vessel from the left side, etc., so it is associated with these vascular anomalies also. So the main supply of the RLN is the cricothyroid muscle and continues as the superior laryngeal nerve. So they also supply sensory fibers to the mucous membrane below the level of the vocal folds. So what happens if you injure a recurrent laryngeal nerve? What do you call? So if you injure the RLN, there are certain scenarios where RLN can be voluntarily taken off. For example, in extensive carcinomas where you can't identify any structure clearly. So that indicates itself that there is an extensive metastasis and infiltration into the surrounding structures. So in that cases, you can always sacrifice the RLN, because if you leave behind the tumor tissue for the sake of the RLN, the patient will again land up in recurrence. So that it is better to sacrifice the RLN for carcinoma in any scenario. So coming to the left, there are again left and right. The left one is about 12 centimeters. So it comes from the vagus in the mediastinum, arch behind the aorta. This is the tracheoesophageal groove on both sides. So on the left, it arches below the arch of aorta, whereas on the right, it arches behind the subclavian artery. So RR, right recurrent, I have already said. So this is another nerve, which is the superior laryngeal nerve, which arises from the inferior ganglion of the vagus. So it descends behind the internal carotid artery. At the level of hyoid, it gives internal branch and external branch. That is, internal is always sensory and external is the motor branch. This is the superior laryngeal nerve, come from the vagus. So the external branch of the superior laryngeal nerve, it should always be again careful because it runs in parallel with the superior thyroid vessels. So while ligating the superior thyroid vessel, you should always be sure that you are not tying the nerve with it. So here you can see in close proximity to the superior thyroid nerve, external branch of the superior thyroid nerve. So while ligating it, it always be sure that only the vessel, that is artery or vein, artery and vein should be ligated. So all these are important in the postgraduate level where the surgery and what you are dissecting is very important. So, for the historical perspective, we just remember the terms, that is burst triangles and or reduced triangle. So here the medial border is the RL nerve, lateral is the common carotid, and superior is the inferior thyroid artery. So while you are seeing from the lateral side, so the medial border is from the this is the medial border where you have RL nerve. The lateral is the carotid. The superior is the, this is the inferior thyroid, this is the inferior thyroid. Under microscopic structure, thyroid consists of the follicular cells. The follicular cells are lined around the central pool of colloid. This forms a follicle. So a thyroid lobule consists 20 to 40 follicles and is supplied by lobular artery. So the superior and inferior thyroid arteries gets divided into these small lobular arteries. As you can see, this is the colloid. This is the colloid and the follicular cells lining it. And between the each follicle, the tissue present between those follicles, there is the parafollicular cells. Coming to the physiological aspect, thyroid mainly secretes two hormones, that is the T3 and T4. T3 is the triiodothyronin, which is formed by the fusion of two hormones, that are monoiodothyrosine and dihydrothyrosine, which bonds and forms the triiodothyrosine. So these hormones are stored in the follicles, which are bound to the protein called as thyroglobulin. Of these two, 90% of the secretory hormone is always T4, but T3 is the active form of the thyroid hormones. So the active form is T3. While T4 is the most commonly secreted, depending upon the bodily requirements, T4 gets converted into T3 in the peripheral tissues. So depends on the body requirements. Coming to regulation of thyroid, you already might have come across this in your physiology, so I'm not going in detail into it. So the main steps involving the thyroid hormone synthesis is the thyroglobulin synthesis, iodine trapping, oxidation, iodination, coupling, storage and release. Under these steps, you should always remember the physiology of thyroid hormone synthesis. So thyroglobulin is a large glycoprotein containing 140 molecules of amino acids, tyrosine. So this is the main protein involved with thyroid hormone synthesis. So thyroglobulin is stored in the, again, follicle. So whatever the iodine you have come coming into the body through dietary intake gets transported from the blood into the follicular cells. So this is called as the iodine trapping. So iodine is transported into the follicular cell along with the sodium. So this is known as the iodine pump. So iodine, the sodium iodide is called as importer pump. So sodium and iodine both enter into the follicular cell. The sources of iodine are always seafood and dairy products. Iodine is the salt which is extensively propagated through government initiatives. Before, it is used to be the rock salt. So in the 60s and 70s, the most commonly used salt is always the rock salt. So after the iodine deficiency, which is developing in India, the government took the initiative and included iodine in the salt. So what we use daily is the iodized salt these days. So then comes the oxidation of the iodine. So here the iodide is turned into iodine. The enzyme thyroid peroxidase, oxidation of iodide into iodine occurs. As I said earlier, the diiodothyrosine and the monoiodothyrosine fuse to form the triiodothyrosine, which is the active form of the most active form of the thyroid hormones. So coming to the normal levels, these are the normal levels. TSH is about 0.3 to 4.0 milligrams, milli units per liter, whereas T4 is, T4 is 4 to 11 micrograms per deciliter, and T3 is 75 to 175 nanograms per deciliter. Coming to functions of thyroid hormones, there are different systems on which the thyroid hormones affect. So on the basal metabolic rate, so they regulate the overall body metabolism. As T3 is the most active form of the hormones, it increases the basal metabolic rate. So that is why when you have a increase in thyroid hormones, the patient is always will have sweating and hunger, etc., due to the body's increased basal metabolic rate. So as said earlier, this T3 increases oxygen consumption and increases body heat production. So thyroxine again increases the absorption of glucose from the GI tract, enhances the glucose uptake by the cells by accelerating the transport mechanism. So it also increases the breakdown of glycogen into glucose and increases the gluconeogenesis. So again, on the fat metabolism, thyroxine increases the free fatty acid available in the blood. Thyroxine is always important in the development of brain. if the patient is untreated hypothyroid patient, so in the early neonatal group or in the early childhood, when left untreated, this can cause permanent developmental disorders in the child. Depending on the hyperthyroid and hypothyroid features, they are broadly classified into different sets. There are hypothyroid disorders, there are hyperthyroid disorders. So can anyone say the hyper and hypothyroid symptoms? In hypothyroid, what you will see is dry hair, puffy face, constipation. There is decreased heart rate in hypo. As I have said in the previous slide, hyperthyroid always have an increased basal metabolic rate. So heart rate is always increased in the hyper, whereas in hypo there is decreased heart rate. So as it is a developmental issue, due to hypothyroidism, there is always a depression. The patient will always be depressive. So he will always be fatigued, depressive, very low. So there will be coming to the androgen part. In females, there will be heavy menstrual cycles in the hypothyroid patient. Whereas in hyperthyroidism, there will be scanty menstrual history. The most common feature is cold intolerance in hypothyroidism and heat intolerance in hyperthyroidism. So you can remember the hyperthyroidism because as the patient is already in increased catabolic state, will always be intolerant to heat. He's sweaty. So again, T3 participant in osteoblast differentiation and its maturation leads to the bone ossification. So this is all I have just said to you. So thyroxine increases the appetite and food intake because you are in a constant catabolic state. Good thing, basal metabolism increases means everything is increased. Increased cardiac output, increase in stimulation of lipolysis, increase in protein breakdown, etc. These are the applied anatomy. While doing a case of thyroid, you should always remember the presence of these structures. So they are not present in every individual, or about 70% of the individuals will be normal. But in the rest, these can be present. As I said in the first or second slide, thyroid artery, if you don't look for it and blindly do the dissection, what happens is there is a sudden sudden bleeding. You don't know what you have got because you didn't look for the thyroid artery. So there are thyroglossal cysts which can be a remnant of the thyroglossal ducts. So these are the different structures which might be present in the thyroid. Pyramidal lobe and ectopic thyroid glands, which are most commonly it is called as lingual thyroid because thyroid tissue will be present in the lingua. So that can be present in some cases. So pressure symptoms and nerve involvements are present in huge goiters. So some thyroid glands can weigh about 600 grams, etc. The normal weight is what 20 to 25 grams. But it, I have seen few cases which are half a kilo in size. So that kind of enlargements can cause pressure symptoms. What happens in pressure symptoms is the thyroid gets compressive effects, causes compressive effects on the surface, in the structures present behind the thyroid that are trachea and esophagus. So while the patient tries to eat something, he cannot pass the deglutition effect is lost. Patient suffers to eat. And in some patients, there is the stridor and wheeze. Patient can't inhale freely due to the big, large goiter compressing the airway. These are the pressure symptoms. This is in brief about the anatomy and physiology. In the next class, we'll go deeper into the main topic, that is the thyroid disorders. There are different thyroid disorders. For example, Graves' disease, which is common in hyperthyroid patients, hyper disorders, non-neoplastic goiters, and then in the end, we'll go into the carcinomas, that is papillary, medullary, and then follicular carcinomas. I won't discuss with you in detail about all those because at undergraduate and fourth semester, I'll just give you a brief idea about the different kinds of disorders. So in the last class, I'll show you the surgery, which is more interesting. So that's it for today.